With the new goal of NASA to get humans back on the moon by 2024 with the Artemis program, we are back to a similar situation to when Apollo was getting ready to go to the moon in the 1960s. Basically, we needed to find somewhere to land. And while you may be thinking, well, why can't we just land anywhere, or even next to Apollo 11, just to prove all the naysayers wrong, there are a new set of requirements for Artemis. This time around, we'll be looking for places that could support long-term bases for years, not just a couple of days. And for that, we need to know much more about the moon than for Apollo. And this is why we needed the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. Now, during that mapping process, it did something that no previous orbiter had been able to do, and that was to image the Apollo sites for the first time in 5 decades, as well as some other much more recent arrivals on the moon. This video is sponsored by Brilliant. Things have changed a lot since the mid-60s and before Apollo 11 landed. Back then, there were no reconnaissance satellites capable of imaging the moon in detail. In 1959, the Soviet Luna 3 mission had imaged the far side of the moon, but the resolution was low. We could get better images of the Earth-facing side from here on Earth, but to land on it, we needed much higher resolution, which was beyond any terrestrial telescopes. So a sequence of Ranger probes would be launched by NASA to get close-up high-res images of the moon's surface. After a bit of a rocky start in 1961, the Ranger program got the name of the Shoot and Hope program because the first 6 probes failed in one way or another. Finally, with the Block 3 missions from 1964 to 65, they got the results they needed. This was achieved by crashing the probes, which were fitted with 6 different TV cameras, onto the surface of the moon at the desired locations and relaying the TV pictures back live to Earth as it happened. Although it sounds a bit drastic, it worked, and in the final few seconds of each flight, they produced the highest resolution images yet taken of the moon and the areas that would later become the landing sites for the Apollo missions. Spool forward to early 2005 and the renewed interest in returning to the moon with a Constellation program, which was meant to put men back onto the moon in a more permanent fashion no later than 2020. To do this, they would need to find any deposits of water on the lunar surface, not only for making drinking water, but also for splitting it into hydrogen and oxygen, which can make electricity with fuel cells and can also make rocket fuel to carry missions onto Mars and beyond, as well as supply oxygen to breathe. Back in the Apollo days, it was thought that the moon was essentially dry with almost no water. But with the landing of the Soviet Luna 24 probe in 1976, which returned lunar samples back to Earth, it was found that they contained 0.1% of water by mass. This led to the thought that there might be a lot more water on the moon than was first thought, with deposits of water ice in the permanently shadowed craters of the moon's south pole. So to map the moon in much greater detail than anything before, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, or LRO, was conceived. This would not only image the surface with its 2 cameras down to a 0.5 meter per pixel resolution, but also had a range of other instruments on board, including a laser altimeter, radiation detector, RF frequency radar, neutron detector, surface temperature detector, and an ultraviolet mapping system that would use the light from stars to help look for water deposits. The LRO was launched on the 18th of June 2009 and entered the moon's orbit 5 days later. Although its primary mission wasn't to look for the remains of the Apollo program, with less than a month to the 40th anniversary of Apollo 11 landings, the principal investigator for the LRO camera, Mark Robinson, wondered if they could image the Apollo sites in time for the anniversary celebrations. As the LRO had only been in orbit for a few weeks and the commissioning work for the instruments was still ongoing, it was going to be touch and go if there was going to be enough time. The LRO was still settling into its orbit from its arrival at about 50 kilometres, twice the height it would normally be at, which also would have an effect on the images. With about a week until the anniversary, the command was given to image the sites of the LRO passed overhead, and revealed them for the first time since they landed. The images were better than expected and showed the remains not only of the descent stages of the Apollo missions, but also the lunar rovers of Apollo 15, 16 and 17, as well as the science experiments left behind and even the shadows of the US flag still standing. More interestingly, they revealed the footprints left behind as the astronauts walked or bunny hopped across the surface. This was helped by the low sun angle, which created long shadows. These could be seen to move as the LRO imaged the same areas throughout the lunar day, which was 29.5 Earth days in duration. So 14.75 Earth days of sunlight and 14.75 Earth days of nighttime. This top-down view became of great interest because it could show for the first time exactly where the astronauts had been, which could be correlated with the rocks they collected and the photos they took. On the Apollo 14 mission, for example, the astronauts were due to go to a nearby crater called Cone Crater to collect rock samples from around the edge. The journey was about 1.5 kilometres by foot, and after around about 2.5 hours, some 30 minutes longer than expected, they still couldn't see the crater, and the maps they had were not of a high enough resolution to know their exact location. So they collected their rock samples from where they were and returned back to the lander. With the new LRO images, it could be seen that they were in fact within 30 metres of the rim of a crater and missed out on the view across and down into it. On the Apollo 12 mission, they landed within walking distance of the Surveyor 3 probe, which had landed in 1967. And again showed a top-down view of the route they had taken to get there. On the later missions with the rovers, you can see where they went on the longer journeys, and the large boulders and craters they filmed and photographed are all visible from the LRO. The Lunar Orbiter Laser Altimeter or LOLA instrument could also see the surface of the contour map. This had a resolution of 9 centimetres from 50 kilometres high, and as such could see the Apollo sites and others like the Soviet Lunokhod rover missions, but there was a problem with some of the experiments left behind by both the Soviets and the US. The laser ranging retroreflector was left at the site of Apollo 11, 14 and 15, and a similar setup by the Soviet lunar rovers. These consist of a series of corner cube reflectors which reflect light back from the same direction that it came. These are the only experiments left by Apollo and the Lunokhod missions that are still working, and they are used to this day to measure the distance between the Earth and the Moon. This is done by firing a laser from the Earth to the reflector on the Moon and then measuring the time it takes to get there and back, which is used to calculate the distance. Firing from the Earth means that the width of the laser beam by the time it gets to the Moon is 6.5 kilometres across and extremely faint. But the LRO's laser is only 30 kilometres away under normal conditions and as such much more powerful. So it has to be turned off when flying over these sites or it could blind or damage the optical sensor on the LRO. However, in 2017, the altitude of the LRO was increased and along with the decreasing strength of the laser, allowed these sites to be finally mapped and the data integrated into a detailed contour map. The ability to vary the altitude of the LRO down to about 20 kilometres has allowed it to get not only better images of the Apollo era sites, but also of much newer ones like the crash site of the Indian moonlander Vikram and the Chinese Chang'e 4 lander and rover U2, which landed on the far side of the Moon in January 2019, and also the Israeli lunar lander Bereshit, which almost landed on the surface in April 2019. But the primary reason for the lower altitude was to get closer to the permanently shadowed craters of the South Pole, like the Shackleton crater, to look for water ice with its variety of instruments. The LRO has also been a testbed for laser communications in deep space by sending high-speed data to and from NASA's Goddard Space Center to the LRO. By 2011, and after the initial exploration phase had ended, the LRO had sent back over 192 terabytes of data, more than all the other planetary missions combined. With the LRO's continuous mapping of the Moon, it has been able to see things that would otherwise be missed. There have been reports of bright flashes seen on the Moon for hundreds of years. More recently, it's suspected that these were meteors hitting the surface, but now they could compare temporal image pairs basically before and after images of where the flashes occurred. One impact, which occurred on the 18th of March 2013, made a flash 10 times brighter than anything seen before. The new LRO image of the same area after the flash showed a new crater 18 metres across. It's thought that the meteor was travelling at about 90,000 kilometres an hour and was about 30 centimetres across with a mass of 40 kilograms. The resultant explosion was equivalent to about 5 tonnes of TNT. Although the crater wasn't that large, the debris field extended up to 30 kilometres away, helped by the low gravity and lack of atmosphere. As of 2016, the LROC team, using these before and after images, had discovered over 47,000 new splotches on the moon. The LRO has enough fuel to last at least another 5 years or more, if funding is still available. But hopefully, with the Artemis program coming in 2024, there'll be plenty more time to find new landing sites and image the moon to its fullest extent. Robotic probes like the LRO have become the mainstay of space exploration. In fact, if you think about it, it's rather ironic, but we need to send many different types of probes like the LRO to discover if a journey to places like the moon by man is indeed possible. Which raises a question: do we as humans need to go at all? Some people think that we should be doing many more cheaper robotic missions instead of looking at the very expensive manned ones, but that's the subject for another video. In the meantime, we still need people to make and operate these robotic missions, and that needs people with high-tech skills, and our sponsors of this video, Brilliant, can help you understand these challenges. Brilliant is a fun problem-solving website and app, so you're not tied to the desktop and you can help develop those learning skills anywhere. Research shows that doing problem solving is more effective than watching lectures. Brilliant's approach is based on this active problem solving and learning method. It's about seeing concepts visually and interacting with them so you can remember them. Their courses are laid out like a story and can be broken down into pieces so that you can tackle them a little bit at a time. There's no big deal here. There's no tests or grades. If you make a mistake along the way, you just need to check out the explanation to find out more. Brilliant has something for everyone, whether you want to start with the basics of maths, science, or computer science, or even head on to the stars with classical mechanics and gravitational physics. If you want to support Curious Droid and get unlimited access to all of Brilliant's in-depth courses and learning, head on over to brilliant.org/curiousdroid and follow the sign-up link. And to close the video, I'd just like to say a big thank you to all of our patrons out there for their ongoing support.